Good morning, everyone, and happy Easter. My name is David Ensley. I am the music director at Oak Ridge Unitarian. And I'd like to welcome everyone to this joint service of Foothills Unitarian Universalist Fellowship and Oak Ridge Unitarian Universalist Church. Let's join together in singing our gathering song. It's Morning Has Come. The music you'll be hearing is from Jason Shelton's recording from around 2004. And the song starts off with a soloist introducing the song. Let's join in singing.
Morning has come. Arise and greet the day. Dance with joy and sing a song of gladness. The light of hope here shines upon each face. May it bring faith to guide our journey.
Good morning, ORUUCians and FUUFians. Welcome to this special joint Easter service of the Foothills Unitarian Universalist Fellowship and the Oak Ridge Unitarian Universalist Church in Oak Ridge.
Well, we would not have wished for the circumstances that have us meeting online instead of in person on this Easter morning. We are grateful for the opportunity to join in this celebration together.
We'd like to give a special welcome to people just finding us for the first time. In the chat box, you'll notice two links for newcomers, which you click to enter your name and information. That helps us keep in touch with you about how to get involved in the days coming ahead.
And if you're a guest today, of course, you're experiencing two congregations at the same time. That means immediately after the service, you have two options to choose from. To join in the FUUF coffee hour, go to the Zoom room you'll see in the chat box. And if you miss that right now, it'll also be on a slide at the end of the service.
For people curious to know more about Oak Ridge UU Church, every week we have a session called Inquirers, where newcomers can get to know each other while getting to learn about ORUUC and Unitarian Universalism. A link will also be in the chat box and a slide at the end of the service.
Whoever you are, whatever your story, whether you're from Blount County or Anderson or Roane County or anywhere, you are welcome here.
Good morning, everybody. Now I'd like to invite us into a moment of prayerful contemplation as we light our virtual chalice. The earth laughs in the bursting of flowers. She sings in the sleepy song of rain. A new dream creeps through the soil, wanting to catch up to the immortal triumph of spring, to have its own song to sing. Maybe we are that seed today, slow to grow, knowing that a new world is on the way. Maybe we are underground. Maybe we are waiting, like the women at the tomb of Jesus when the rock was removed to reveal an empty wonder, sorrow and awe together as one at last. At last, this is what it means to be alive, to feel the fullness, the depths and the reaches, to love and love and love again, to love ourselves, our neighbors, the stranger and the friend. To live is to be in between beginnings and ends. Ends always passing into beginnings, which pass to ends again. We were always in between. We people with hearts big enough to know when we do not know, and I do not know how this will end. But I know that each day is a chance to bend with the wind, to start again, to seek the truth. And though the times may feel brutal, we might yet return to love and nurture our renewal.
And now join me in singing Sanctuary.
Gather this morning in all our diversity of identities, our differences of life experience, each of us coming here to this time and place, however we are, with our unique burdens and joys. And as we do so, we affirm that we bring ourselves fully and wholly here. We make that space. And when we do that, when we bring ourselves as gifts to one another, we are able to create a sanctuary, even here in this virtual space. So in this sanctuary, I invite you to join me now in the spirit of prayer. Spirit of life, God who is love, gather us in this morning gather us in with gratitude and thanksgiving. We give thanks for the beauty of this day, for the signs of new life all around us, even in the midst of hard times. We give thanks for the moments in our everyday lives when more love can break through and we remember who we are and what is most important. We give thanks this morning for people past and present who have been teachers to us, who have called our names, who have pulled us at times out of despair and grief and confusion into a wider place of possibility. And we give thanks for the persistence of communities of memory and hope, carriers of living tradition, bringing old stories to new life. We ask for help this morning, staying awake to the pain and the promise of this world, and that we may be ones full of courage and creativity and compassion, ones who create a world where all people have access to the gifts of this beautiful life, this beautiful planet Earth. May it be so, and amen.
And now we move into the part of worship where we get to bring a little bit of ourselves to the table and make some meaning with the symbols and the space we have at our disposal. So for our altar building, I'd invite you to share a word, a thought, a feeling, an intention into our chat box over here to fill that space, fill that virtual space up. You might also light a candle and hold it up to the camera to share that light with all of your neighbors and friends, new friends, old friends. And you might also email a prayer request to the email address listed on the screen, oruuc.community.prayers@gmail.com. And now we're going to listen to some lovely music played by Hannah White. Let's fill the space up with our intentions and our words and our light.
You're broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round. You can't find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we're gonna walk it out. We're gonna walk it out. Move mountains. And I'll rise like the day. I'll rise unafraid. I'll rise up and I'll do it a thousand times again. Yes, I'll rise up. You. pleasant, quiet. It feels like it's getting hard to breathe. Now I know you feel like dying, but I promise we'll bring the world to its feet. Move mountains, bring it to its feet, yes.
That was so beautiful to see your faces and your candles and your families together, all our different settings. Want to make space now and invite you into a time for prayers of our community. Begin by just breathing a full breath in and blowing it out. And do that a few times, breathing in through your nose and out through your mouth, just to come into the rhythm of your body, to come into this time of shared prayers of our community. Breathing in, blowing it out. And if you would now, pay attention to the space where you are seated. Notice your feet. How they are supported by the floor and the back of your chair or seat supporting you. Take a moment to feel where you are in your body. And as you close your eyes gently, just notice for a moment the sounds around you. Let the silence give you space for hearing what you usually do not notice. Just a moment to listen. A And then go on in again to your breathing, breathing in and out, just noticing that breath, going inward, paying attention. O Spirit of Life, best known as love, we give thanks this day. Thanks for all that is our life, all the particulars of our own lives, and also the blessing of our shared life together. Let us hear now these particular prayers of this gathered community. Let us call to mind and heart the Campbell family, Barbara and David Campbell, and their three children, longtime members of the Oak Ridge Church, who moved away about 8 years ago. Let's hold this family in care as they grieve the loss of the mother, Barbara, who died last Tuesday. Let us send them our love, our condolences, our hope that their strong memories of their wife, Barbara, the mother, Barbara, those memories hold them strong in this time. And as we hold the Campbell family, let us also make space, for there are many, many in this country, on this planet, who are grieving the death of loved ones. In this time of gathered community, may we hold in care, may we open our hearts, all who have lost a loved one in this past week. We also have one among us who asks prayers for her son in Virginia and his family. This one's oldest granddaughter, the oldest daughter in that family in Virginia, likely has COVID-19, and the family has gone into quarantine. Let us pray that they be well, that they be safe, that if medical care is needed, that care is available. And as we hold this family in care, one of our own, let us hold all families who are quarantined, who are concerned about a loved one with COVID-19. Let us hold them in our hearts, send healing energy to them, and know that every family struggling with this pandemic is one of our own. We have a prayer from one who says this: let us pray for all who at this time are nurturing life.
When you know,
pray for our parents, our nurses, our doctors, gardeners, teachers, grocery store workers, pastors, boards of churches, and caregivers everywhere. With each helping hand they lend, with each listening ear they provide, they are nurturing life. We are so grateful to all who have been called into extraordinary generosity and care in response to this pandemic. We give thanks and we hold all those brave warriors, all those brave lovers in our embrace. May each of us in this time of uncertainty know there is much to be given and that there is much to be received as we are reminded that our singular lives are never enough and we are never alone. We are held by a love that holds us all. Gratitude for all that is our lives. Let us hold a moment of silence together. Amen. As Crystal and Christine lead us in a call to solidarity, please join us in this refrain. You're not alone. We're in this together. We'll do everything we can to help.
For the parents who feel the sadness of not being able to introduce their babies to friends and family because of social distancing. For retired folks who are already struggling to get by, but now watching their shaky financial futures vaporize with every hit the stock market takes. For everyone getting married over the next few months, Try to remember you're not celebrating alone, even if your community can't be there for the ceremony.
You're not alone. We're in this together. We'll do everything we can to help.
For the refugees trying to make sense of this chaos in a foreign country and a language that's often difficult to comprehend. For the small business owners who are forced to close shop out of service to our collective health, but will struggle to stay in business once this all has passed. For single parents who are already under-supported and overworked. For the over 2 million kids in the United States who need public school meal assistance just to get one or two hot meals a day, and their parents who are suffering the pain of seeing their kids go hungry.
You're not alone. We're in this together. We'll do everything we can to help.
For the activists, charities, and nonprofit organizations fighting to build a better world, one donation at a time, while watching their funding thin out. For our elders in assisted living communities who fear they may never see their family again. For the authors, artists, musicians, speakers, and everyone else in the gig industry whose livelihood is dependent on events that have been canceled.
You're not alone. We're in this together. We'll do everything we can to help.
For the immunosuppressed and immunocompromised who fear running down to the market to buy the basics so they can get by one more day. For the undocumented who have been illegalized by an unjust and unwelcoming system, who fear applying for assistance at the risk of deportation. For those who are incarcerated and concerned for their own health in their isolated communities or worried they may lose loved ones they'll never see again.
You're not alone. We're in this together. We'll do everything we can to help.
For the grocery and pharmacy clerks who graciously serve all their customers while making themselves vulnerable. For the hospice workers who wrestle with the risks of showing up or not showing up to care for their patients and the difficult consequences of either choice. For the chefs, bartenders, delivery folks, dishwashers, hosts and hostesses, line cooks, servers, and all the hospitality industry who've prepared and provided meals for us but have lost their jobs.
You're not alone. We're in this together. We'll do everything we can to help.
For parents whose employers won't make concessions for you to stay home with your children who aren't able to attend school. For the healthcare professionals who put themselves in risk to care for the suffering bodies of our collective humanity. For every single one of us who will lose a loved one, a friend, a family member, or a partner to this virus and will be forced to grieve alone.
You're not alone. We're in this together. We'll do everything we can to help.
One thing I have loved about being with you these past almost 20 years is the way we are each invited to bring our gifts, our own gifts to our congregations, to give of our time, talent, and treasure in our own ways and in our own time. Some of us offer our musical talents, some serve in leadership roles, some care for and connect deeply with those in need within our congregation, Some bring passion for social justice and advocacy. And we are also invited to use to receive the gifts we need from our congregations. And we may need to receive different gifts at different times. Many of us have been grateful for connecting, especially with like-minded others in our congregations. At times, we may lean into the strong social justice and advocacy opportunities our congregations offer. And at just the right time for each of us, we may cross into a time of deeper spiritual growth just when we need it. And all along, but especially right now, right here in this time, there is the gift of interconnectedness, that interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. I know we're all soaking that gift up right now and letting our UU communities feed our souls as we connect in new ways that sustain us. For all these gifts of being together in our UU, we are so thankful. And with deep gratitude, we give back generously through our time, talent, and treasure to support the work of Foothills and Oak Ridge UU communities within our congregations and beyond into the broader community. Today, we can give back to the important work of our two congregations. You can support Foothills UU Fellowship by going to fuuf.org/give. And you can support Oak Ridge UU Church by going to oruuc.org/online-giving. And we're always able to send a check by mail as well. In addition, both FUUF and Oak Ridge have programs where our offering each month is shared with community organizations. So a portion of undesignated donations go to the organization designated for that month by the congregation. For those of you supporting the ministries of the Oak Ridge UU Church this morning, the Split the Plate recipient for the month of April is Blossom Center for Childhood Excellence, a 24-hour childcare facility founded by one of ORUUC's own members and supported through many volunteer hours by many church members. Each week, half of undesignated gifts at ORUUC go to support the Split the Plate recipient, with the other half supporting the ministries of Oak Ridge. This month's Share the Plate organization at FUUF is the Blount County Office on Aging, which provides seniors with information and education on caregiving and Medicare, powerful advocacy on issues important to seniors, and a volunteer senior transportation program called SMILES. Any donations designated fully for Share the Plate or Office on Aging go in full to that organization, and 1/4 of other undesignated non-pledged donations will go to support the Office on Aging, with all remaining funds going to support Foothills UU Fellowship. So we invite you now, as you feel called, to go ahead and donate online. Feel free to take a moment to do that during the beautiful offertory song we're about to hear, or know that you may send a check by mail or donate online at your convenience anytime. And thank you for all the gifts you bring to our congregations.
It's been a long, dark night, and I've been waiting for the morning. It's been a long, hard fight, but I see a brand new day dawning. Yeah, I've been looking for the sunshine. Everything's gonna be all And I can see the light of a clear blue morning. Yeah, I can see the light of a brand new day. Yeah, I can see the light of a clear blue morning. Everything's gonna be alright. Everything's gonna be alright.
Thank you.
Will you all please join me in reciting the covenant of the Foothills Unitarian Universalist Fellowship as we dedicate all the gifts among us to the work of love in this
Early
world.
Early on the first day of the week, while it
love is the spirit of this fellowship, and service is its blessing. To dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. This is our great covenant.
The week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him."
So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in.
Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen.
Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying.
Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot.
They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?"
"They've taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him."
At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus.
He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for?"
Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him, and I will get him."
Jesus said to her, "Mary."
He turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher.
Most years, Easter comes with pastel colors and familiar traditions. We look forward to the egg hunt in the yard and maybe a big meal in the afternoon with family or friends, and of course revisiting the ancient beloved story of Easter morning. But in the last month, the whole world is shut down. So this year, maybe, Easter comes to us from a different angle and in a new light. The theologian Walter Brueggemann said that if you read the Psalms, those ancient Jewish texts, you can divide them into three categories. He said that there are Psalms of orientation, which describe a world that is normal and familiar, He said there are psalms of disorientation when all is plunged into confusion and a pit of despair with seemingly no way out. And thirdly, he said there are psalms of reorientation in which we are lifted up out of that pit and can see the world anew as if for the first time, saturated with holy beauty we might not have otherwise seen. He said that these aren't just categories to describe how to look at the Psalms, but also how to understand phases of our own lives. If that's true, then it may be that the life we had known in conditions of orientation and familiarity now have been plunged into a time and a season this Easter of disorientation.
Imagine waking up early before dawn that first Easter morning. Those who loved Jesus, who called him teacher, could hardly believe their great loss. They knew the domination of the Roman Empire. They had seen other crucifixions and grieved other losses, but it wasn't supposed to happen to him. Jesus' death was unthinkable. And by unthinkable, I mean those things that we can't quite look at rationally. We can't quite look at it head on. Both the terrible and the beautiful can at times be unthinkable. It's those experiences we have and wonder, did that really happen? So Mary and the other disciples were left wondering, how could it be that he is gone? When just a few days ago, all seemed hopeful and triumphant, a healer and a liberator was entering Jerusalem, the embodiment of their hope. Mary was in that place of shock and grief that follows the loss of someone dear, when your whole world is turned inside out. Many of you have experienced that place before. She stays near Jesus' tomb. She weeps and she grieves and she wants to care for his body, as was the custom. But to her surprise, he's not there, or at least his body isn't. And now it's even more disorienting. She can't even do the ritual she's supposed to be doing. What in the world is happening? What we are living through right now is also unthinkable in its own way. None of us have ever lived through a global pandemic. We thought it was a thing of the past. Just a few short months ago, we could not have imagined this life that we're in now. We could not have imagined people sick and dying of the same disease every single day all over the globe. We could not have imagined that we would have lived through 4 weeks of physical distancing from people that we love, 4 weeks of schools closed, 4 weeks of wearing gloves and masks when we go out to the grocery store, 4 weeks of businesses being shuttered and people out of work more and more every day. In this time of grief, we can't even gather in person for our grounding rituals of comfort. In this time of disorientation, we realize that nothing will ever be the same again. To think that we will be the same again is to deny the depth of the losses we have experienced. The women in the gospel stories of Jesus' death had that wisdom. The wisdom to not deny the depth of the loss. The wisdom to stay, to not run away, to stay and to weep, to grieve, to remember. When our hearts and our sense of reality is broken open, broken wide open, perhaps this is the time when we are most able to hear and to heed love's call.
In the Easter story, there comes this moment where Mary is there and her heart is broken wide open. Her whole sense of reality is broken wide open. All that she had hoped for, counted on, is now gone from the world. And it's just at that moment that the unthinkable happens. A stranger approaches her and greets her. She doesn't know who he is. She thinks he's the gardener. And then he calls her by name. Mary, he says. And it's like she wakes up. Walter Brueggemann might say that this was a moment of reorientation, or you might say it was the resurrection of all that had been lost and seemingly gone from the world. Teacher, she cries out. And maybe you know what that moment is like in your own life. Maybe it was a time when you were falling in love or falling back in love after a very long time. Maybe there was this afternoon when you were out in the woods and the whole world seemed to glisten, or some time when you were heartbroken at church and someone sang a song and you knew, you were reminded that we are never alone. This is the nature of love. It calls out to us in a particular way with a particular song. I think about it sort of like the Australian zebra finches. Ornithologists have discovered that the mother zebra finch will sing to her eggs in a particular way depending on the temperature that year. In a warmer year, she'll sing one song. In a cooler year, she'll sing another. And depending on that song, they've identified the song as the variable. Depending on that song, those hatchlings will come into the world and develop to a particular size. This is the nature of love. It sings into our lives with a particular purpose in a particular way for a particular moment. And we are invited, when we hear it, to respond with our lives. What is it this morning love is singing to you? What's the invitation that love's putting out, hoping you will say yes? If you said yes, if you accepted, if you experienced that moment of reorientation when all the world was reborn, now in holy beauty, what would that be like?
This Easter, our resurrection, our rising up in joy and thanksgiving, does not have to be a shallow reenactment of someone else's story. It does not have to be a tired retelling of a story that we never quite really believed before anyway. It doesn't even have to be just a sunny spring day with bunnies and eggs. This Easter, we find ourselves living in a new world with new meanings. Out of the confusion and the grief and the fear of this time, love yet calls each one of us by our names, turns our heads and hearts towards what is ours to do, reorients us to what is our purpose in this time and in this place. We won't be going back to the way things were, because we have been changed along with the world. To think that we will be the same people on the other side of this is to deny the possibility that we might yet live into a world with more love and compassion and justice for all people. When love calls us, each one of us individually, perhaps we know in our bones that we must rely on one another for our safety. And so we stay apart and yet stay more connected in some ways than we ever have been before. And we do things like make our own masks to protect the healthcare workers. And we send our money to support those laid off workers, and we do the grocery shopping for the neighbors, and we ask the elected officials, we demand that the elected officials let people out of the jails and the detention centers so that they may have a chance at life. And we make our concerts and our classes free for everyone. We share what we have with those in need. When love calls us, perhaps we can slow down. We don't have to rush around doing all the things. buying all the things, trying to be all the things. We can let others help us. We can be the people love calls us to be. And when love calls us, perhaps we are able to see that despite the deep inequities and disparities in our country, there actually is enough food, enough work, enough rest, enough housing, enough income, enough health care for all. And we know we are the ones to make it true. When love calls us, even in the midst of the terrible unthinkable, may we know more deeply than ever how we are meant to rise up. Powerful and unafraid, we rise up over and over and over again for each other and in the service of life. This Easter, may we rise with joy, called by name, by a love that never leaves us, called to our new purpose in this world. May it be so. Amen.
And now let us join together in singing, "Lo, the Earth Awakes Again."
As we go from this place, may we be fools for love and pilgrims for justice. And until we meet again, may we walk, roll, and move in beloved community.
And now, may the love that is within us and the love that flows between us join with that greater love that holds us all. May it shine forth and serve the forces of life today and in the days to come. Go in peace. Amen.